Good evening. Welcome to worship on this Christmas Eve. We're glad to see you here. If you're worshiping with us at home, online, we give you a warm welcome and thank you for joining us this evening for this special service of carols and lights. I remind everyone that there will not be an in-person worship on Sunday, the 26th. We will encourage you to tune in to a pre-recorded worship service provided by the Synod of the Northeast. The way to do that is listed in the bulletin, or you can go right to our church website and be guided there for the Christmastide service. The Synod has generously provided this opportunity for all church staffs to have a day off. Also, if you have donated a poinsettia and are going to take it with you, please come up at the conclusion of the service and pick one out that suits your fancy and take it with you. If you want to leave them here, they'll also be available on Tuesday when the church office is open again. Are there other announcements to share this evening? The peace of Christ be with you.
Behold, I bring good news for all people. Unto us a child is born this night, a Savior, Christ the Lord.
And tonight the angels sing on earth, glory to God in the highest.
Let us pray. Eternal God, from the tabernacle of heaven, to the poverty of a stable, your radiant light shines forth in a tiny baby wrapped in rags. Such humble love astounds us. In Jesus, you have become one with us, that we might become one with you. Open our hearts to joyfully receive his love, that he may be born in us and we in him. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
As is our custom, we light the Advent wreath for the four Sundays of Advent and light then the wreath on Christmas Eve, including the Christ candle, and lighting the wreath tonight is the Franco family. If you want to turn on those mics, I'll get you a light.
In the ancient world, various people lit fires to mark the turning point into the light's winter season and to pray for return of the light. The church has Christianized that practice in the lighting of the Advent wreath. To us, these candles are signs of growing light, of Christ who is coming again in all fulfillment into the darkness of our world. Until the dawning of the great day, we watch and wait in the Holy Spirit for Christ coming into the darkness of our world, lighting candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, and remembering the promises of God with prayer. We have watched, we have waited
in hope
for peace,
in joy,
with love,
now our redemption draws near.
For peace.
In joy.
With love.
And now our redemption draws near. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord."
Glory to God in the highest. Alleluia. Amen.
This is our time to share some thoughts with the children. So invite the kids to come up. Or do we have? Yeah, we got a couple. Come on. Two. Good. Why don't you sit in the front pew right there? It'd be easier. Last time I saw you guys, some of you were shepherds and sheep and Mary and all those kinds of things. Good. Well, what I wanted to talk to you tonight was about babies and Jesus. And when Jesus was born, I wonder what the first thing Mary did to him. Probably they cleaned him up a little bit, and then they gave him to Mary. Here's a couple others. Come on up. But you know, one of the first things I'll bet Mary did was give baby Jesus a kiss. Did you do that? Yep, did you do that with your babies? First one of the first things you do is give them a kiss. Yeah, because they're special. And because they are loved. Yeah, big smile. Yeah. Today we don't give many kisses because of the pandemic, do we? But not with strangers. And so we sort of hold back a little bit. But, you know, giving a kiss or giving a hug or just saying, I love you, is something very special. Something very special. It's a gift we can give not only on Christmas, yeah, but it's a gift we can give all year round. Yeah, baby. Baby, yeah. Yeah, baby, yeah. Yep. So we can give that gift of love in many different ways by showing how we care for each other and how we help each other and how we just are there, and in a time maybe to come that won't be too long, we can give a kiss, okay? On Mother's Day, we gave women kisses in the church, candy kisses, and on Father's Day, we did the same thing. And so I've got some candy kisses here for someone, and if they're not old enough, they can be exchanged for something else, but would you like that? Yeah, okay. How about it, Lily? Would you like some candy kisses? It's even adults get them, yeah. Even Wyatt will appreciate that. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we thank you for the gift of love and the gift of Jesus. Help us to always give that love to others and show it in so many different ways. Thank you for these children and parents and for all the love that they share with us and with each other. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. And if I happen to leave them up here and they disappear during the poinsettia distribution, not going to break my heart, okay? I got enough candy and cookies at home to keep us stocked for another month. This is our time when we share joys and concerns. We ask you to remember those in the bulletin or on our prayer list, and remember all those who need a special message of hope this Christmas time. Are there joys or concerns to share tonight that you'd like me to lift up in prayer? Let's pray together. Gracious God, you came among us as a baby, but you lived among us as a man, and you taught us. You healed. You walked among streets and roads and valleys and hills, and you brought good news. And you gave yourself as a sacrifice for us. We pray tonight thanking you for the gift of your creation, and especially the special gift of Christmas time. We know that in our hearts there are many memories of Christmas. Some of those memories may be good and some of those memories may be painful. But in the midst of joy and of pain, we know you're present. You love us and care for us in special ways. So especially be with those tonight who are hurting, those who are sick, those who are mourning the loss of a loved one, those who are hospitalized or confined to a home or who are quarantined and restless to get out and do things once again. We pray for those who are poor, hungry, homeless, and we pray for those who are victims of violence or poverty. Keep all your children in your heart. Surround them with your love and show us ways that we can be your caring people in this time and place. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The first lesson this evening is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Thank you.
Our second lesson comes from Isaiah, the 11th chapter. The Messiah will come from the root of Jesse to restore the peace of creation. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and the branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and a little child shall lead them. And a lion shall eat straw like the ox, the nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea.
Eastern star that tells us of God's morning.
The third lesson is from the book of Luke, chapter 1, beginning with the 26th verse. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
Fourth lesson this evening comes from the Gospel of Luke, the second chapter. Joseph and Mary travel to Bethlehem, where Mary gives birth to her child. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration that was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
Thank you.
The fifth lesson this evening is from the book of Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. Angels appear to the shepherds in the fields and announce the birth of the Messiah. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you this day, in the city of David, a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them.
Sixth lesson comes from Matthew, the second chapter. Magi from the east come seeking the Messiah and offer gifts to the baby Jesus. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Small child in a land of a thousand.
The seventh lesson this evening is from the book of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. The Word of God becomes flesh and lives among us, full of grace and truth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
Tonight we've been blessed with some great music, and we thank all those who have helped make this a special night through the music of this service. Join me in prayer. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. We live in a time of instant analysis. Thanks to television and social media, there's often a quick reaction to the things that happen in our world and in our community. In the world of sports, no sooner has the dust settled on a football field than a commentator is telling us what we just saw and why we saw it. In politics, as soon as an issue emerges or someone makes a comment, the conversation and debate begins with voices from all sides of the political spectrum speaking up. And in your life and mine, we often want quick answers to our problems. We want that package from Amazon delivered on time, or we get anxious when things happen in our lives that we can't control. There's little time in this modern world for reflection, study, contemplation, or pondering. In the account of Jesus' birth from Luke that Janice read for us this evening, after the visit of the shepherds, Mary pondered all these things in her heart. She pondered what she had seen and what she had heard. She had much to think about. 9 months earlier, she had encountered the angel Gabriel with a message from God that said she was going to give birth, even though she was still a young virgin. And she had to share that news with her betrothed, Joseph, and probably a skeptical family. So she had a difficult time. She watched them struggle with that news, and she was then relieved to see that Joseph put aside his doubts and accepted her. And then there was that meeting with her cousin Elizabeth, who would give birth to John the Baptist. And now this mandatory trip to Bethlehem, of all places, for the Roman census, and having to give birth in a stable, of all places. And just as she was recovering from her labor and getting to know her newborn son and giving him a kiss, those shepherds arrived with a tale of angels in the heavens and sharing the message that had been shared with them. All of this laid heavy on the heart and mind of a young woman, probably 13 to 15 years old. Luke tells us that, to Mary's credit, she does not panic or does she does not get distressed. She takes all these things into her heart, and she instinctively sort of knew that she couldn't make sense out of all this right now, but she would after a time. She needed to trust God who had touched her life so powerfully. And so she pondered what she had seen and what she had heard. For all those things to ponder, the appearance of those shepherds in the stable probably was the most puzzling. You know, over the centuries, much has been made of the role of the shepherds. Shepherds were important in the economy of the world at that time. They provided sheep with care and comfort, and those sheep in turn provided their wool and their meat. Their care and protection was important not only to the owner of the flock, but all who depended on the sheep. Yet it was work that was reserved for people who were just barely getting by in the world. You didn't get rich being a shepherd. It wasn't just another rung on the ladder to success. Being a shepherd was hard work. They were outside in all kinds of weather. They managed sheep that had a tendency to wander off and get lost or get into trouble. They had to care for the injuries and illnesses of the flock, and they had to be alert to predators, both human and animal. The pay wasn't great considering the responsibility that was placed on their shoulders. And yet their work became a model in Scripture for our God and our Savior. Think of the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd." Or Jesus' words, "I am the good shepherd." A shepherd was faithful. A shepherd was trustworthy. A shepherd was steady and responsible and had to be patient and caring. A shepherd had to know where to take the sheep to find good grass and fresh and safe water and shelter when there was bad weather. And the owner of the flock could entrust the shepherd because he had confidence in the work of the shepherd. But these were not the kind of people you'd expect God to announce the birth of his son, the Savior coming into the world. If you and I had an important announcement to make, it would probably not have been made to a gathering of shepherds somewhere out in a remote field outside of Bethlehem. Announcement like this should be made in a place of importance, a temple in front of the high priest, or the royal palace to the ears of King Herod, or at least in the common marketplace in Jerusalem so the news would spread quickly. But to a sheep shepherd and a group of sheep, someone once said the angel must have had a faulty GPS. Yet it was the shepherd's words to Mary and Joseph that caused Mary to tuck them away in her heart. Over 2,000 years later, the words of the angels to the shepherds and how they acted on those words are an example of God's work in our world. While it was a long time ago, those shepherds lived in a world not that dissimilar from ours. Now, the technology and culture were different, of course, yet many of the realities of their lives mirror the realities of our lives. There was a strong and powerful government in Rome with its laws and rules and military. Taxes were a way of life, and it was not always easy to make a living and provide for yourself and your family. Even in those fields outside of Bethlehem, those shepherds could see off in the distance the dim lights of a village, reminding them of the larger world of which they were part. So we too do not live in isolation from others and the realities of our world, realities that at times can be overwhelming. When the shepherds first heard God's message, they were afraid of all, as all of us probably would be. What does this mean? And yet there it was in front of them, a chorus of angels that the long-awaited Messiah is born. God speaks in our time and in our place. Often God's voice is hard to hear with all the other noise and distractions around us. Yet God has a word for us, and perhaps that word comes to us tonight through the voice of the shepherds. That word may be different for each one of us. For some who are caught up in fear, perhaps of COVID-19, and there's a message that God is with us and working through the health community to address the pandemic. There are some tonight who are grateful for the presence of support of family and friends. Maybe you're together for the first time in a while. So the shepherds have a message of love for you. And there are some who are in pain, maybe physical pain or spiritual pain or emotional pain. The shepherds have a message of comfort and endurance and patience. And for some of us who will be with family and friends during the special holiday time, it's a reminder to be thankful for the grace that we've been given. And for those of us who will be alone or separated by distance or COVID from loved ones, the shepherds have a message of peace for our hearts. And for those struggling with the challenges of life, it's a message of hope. Hope for the future. Hope in God. May each of us find the message of the angels tonight. But the story of the shepherds did not end with hearing that message in the field. They just didn't go back to the sheep or lay down for their night's rest. They talked among themselves. The fact that they shared what we had heard is an important lesson for us today. Spiritual experiences, holy encounters with God, should be shared with others. Sharing with others helps us ponder and make sense of what we may have experienced. It helps make it real in our lives. Sharing with others, we may be able to give them a little bit of light that helped them on their path. After sharing with others, those shepherds decided that some of them should go and see this baby and this new family. They acted, but they acted responsibly, leaving a shepherd or two behind to care for the flock and protect the sheep. They did not abandon their responsibilities. And they traveled quickly. And they arrived at the stable and humbly shared what God had told them. They delivered their message, paid their respects, went back to their flocks and to their work. And in so doing, they gave Mary and us more to ponder in our hearts. This Christmas Eve, the shepherds have once again come to the stable, a humble place in our hearts. They've come to say that God has done a great and powerful thing in Jesus Christ. Those shepherds speak to us where we are and know the challenges we face. They've come with a message of love, peace, joy, and hope. And like Mary, we're invited to take that message into our hearts and to ponder the work of God who's at work in us this very night. Amen. We move now to the lighting of the Christmas candles, and we invite you to be careful when you go to extinguish them, that you do not blow hard, just a little bit on the bottom of the mass to extinguish the candle. And we invite you to remember that the light that we have comes from God, and that the light we have helps guide us through the path of life. I'll ask the candle lighters to come forward. Now go in peace. And may the blessings of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost be abide with you this day, this night, and forevermore. Amen.